سلام عزیزان، امروز مهمان بسیار عزیزی دارم. اصلا خودم هیجان زیادی دارم. ایشون منو توی برنامه تلویزیونیش مصاحبه کرده، امروز هم ایشون مهمان منه، ولی فرق داره. ایشون در تمام آمریکا شناخته شده است، برنامه رادیویی تلویزیونی خودشو داره، کتاب‌های زیادی نوشته شده که فروشترین تو آمریکا بوده، ایشون مشاور رئیس جمهورهای مختلف بوده، یعنی شخصیه که هم در ایمان، هم در میدیا و هم در سیاست ایشون خبره هستن. برای من خوشحالم که اریک رو به شما معرفی کنم. Welcome to our show.
Thank you, my friend. A delight to be here. My honor to be here.
Well, it's an honor to have you. I just shared with our audience about your work very briefly. I know you've written many books.
I don't understand what you said?
I will.
Yeah. I don't know. Let me think how much Farsi I know. Actually, you know what? Not one word. Now that you mentioned it,
okay.
Not one word.
We all know English, so, and they love to speak English. It's an honor to have you. And I want to ask you about your personal journey.
Yeah.
I know how you came to Christ relates to many people in Iran.
Yes.
Why? Because of Islam, people of Iran have said, if this is the best religion,
yeah,
I'm done.
Yeah.
Either there is no God,
right,
or it's irrelevant.
Right.
So I think your testimony will bless them.
Well, where do I start? Let me start here. My father grew up in Greece. My mother grew up in Germany. So they experienced tremendous suffering in the war and after the war, hunger, misery. We all know the story of Europe. They came both to New York City in the 50s. They met in an English class in New York City. So I always joke around, if you're raised Greek and German, that means you will be raised Greek. There's no way around it. The Greek, you know, ethnicity is very powerful. Greeks are proud to be Greek. And so I was raised in the Greek community in New York. And what it means to be Greek for many Greeks is we go to the Greek church. The problem is there's a wonderful ethnic identity, very warm community, but you're there mainly because that's what Greeks do. So in a funny way, even though I was raised going to church, I didn't get the details. Do we really believe this? Why do we believe this? Is this true? Or are these fairy tales that we just say because this is our tradition? So by the time I went to college, I went to Yale University. Many people know Yale University. Yale University and other top universities, in fact today most universities, are very secular, very hostile to Christian faith, not interested in being tolerant of it. So suddenly I was challenged, do I believe these things? Are these things true? And I came to the position that the most intelligent, educated people are convinced you cannot know if these things are true. That's the most generous way to put it. Most of them think these things are ridiculous. The Bible is folk tales, ancient things. We all know that's ridiculous. But because I was raised in this tradition, I never rejected it. I only came to the place where I thought, it's impossible to know if this is real, if this is true, if I could have a relationship with God. It's not possible for an intelligent, educated person to have that kind of faith. And so I ended there.
Yeah.
And I was miserable. I always joke around also that they tell you in life and in places like Yale, you know, get a good job and work hard.
Why were you miserable?
Whole, I mean, well, what I'm saying is that they tell you, without words, they basically tell you, don't ask these big questions. Is there a God? What's the meaning of life? Because they're making the point there is no meaning of life. We're just here. We just evolved randomly through accident. But we don't want to talk about it because it's so depressing. So we'll avoid the subject. And as a substitute for thinking about these big things, just get a good job, work hard, be successful. But I was an English major. I wanted to write. I'm a writer now. But I wanted to write. And therefore, I did not get a good job. I graduated, and I drifted, and I floated. What's the meaning of life? What am I doing? You know, all the stuff that if I had some career path, I would have ignored these things. I would just be running after my success. Now, the funny thing is I ended up moving back in with my parents. Now, this is where it gets ugly. because I love my parents very much. I thank God that I still have them. But imagine you come from war-torn countries. You have no food. You come to America. You send your kid to Yale University. You work menial jobs to send your kid to Yale. And then he comes back and says, I don't know what I'm doing. What's the meaning of life? I'm lost. And they look at you thinking, are you kidding? We didn't even dream of going to college. You went to Yale and you did. So it was a very difficult time for me because I was really thinking, what am I going to do with my life? I'm unable to have peace. And I'm unable, imagine if I was thinking, oh, I want to find God. Well, I wasn't even thinking that because I'd been trained to think either there's no God or even if there is, maybe, you can never have that simple faith of believing in the Bible. That's just not possible. So I went through a very difficult time. And about a year after I moved in with my parents, I had met a man. I got a very depressing job.
What were you doing?
I was a proofreader at a chemical conglomerate, Union Carbide in Danbury, Connecticut. And this was like the most miserable thing you could devise for Eric Metaxas because I was the editor of the humor magazine
in college.
Yeah. I'm writing poetry and short stories. I'm creative. This was a nightmare. And I say that I was in a complex about a quarter of a mile from the nearest window, like you're in a fluorescent lit miserable situation. And in the midst of this misery, living with my parents and this, I met a man who was serious about his faith, but very sweet in the way we talked. He was never too forceful, but he was forceful. He kept sharing things with me, and I kept having conversations. And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, don't get too close with this weird Christian stuff because I know you're crazy. But I was in enough pain that I continued the conversation. And at the end of almost a year of holding this at arm's length, the bottom line is something happened. My uncle was sick, and my friend said, oh, why don't we pray for your uncle? And I thought, wow, pray for my uncle, as though there's a God who's going to hear your prayer and heal my uncle. This is amazing, and I'm not sure what I believe, but when you're desperate, when someone's sick, you take him up on it, just in case, right? Anyway, the long story short is that something happened to me, and a couple of weeks later, all I can tell you is I experienced a real miracle, and I needed a miracle because I was so intellectually gummed up, I was so intellectually confused that I needed God to punch through the wall to say, I'm here, And the Lord spoke to me in a dream. I won't tell the story because it's kind of complicated, but the Lord made clear to me in the dream, and I write about it I have a new book out called Fish Out of Water, and I also mention it, I tell the story in my book, Miracles, how God spoke to me in the dream that completely, totally blew my mind forever. I had zero doubt that this was Jesus speaking to me, God speaking to me. I mean, it was something I didn't believe. Going to bed, I didn't believe this was possible.
That's right.
And so when it happened to me, it just blew my mind. And I woke up and I said, that's it. Jesus is Lord. The Bible is true. Everything. But it literally happened overnight.
You have to tell us, dreams and visions, I hear a lot about among Muslims. It happens all the time.
I keep hearing in only among Muslims. Yeah, maybe I'm part Muslim. Yeah, I don't know.
But God's grace covers all of us. And He graciously came to your dream. Tell us about it. I mean, you talked about it. And you're saying,
actually,
what was it? What
it's
was
actually
it?
Complicated. And yeah. People will get confused. But the quickest version is to say that growing up in the Greek community, and I assume that people in Iran have a similar thing, they really celebrate being Greek. They're proud to be Greek. Nobody brings up Xerxes. We don't talk about that. We only talk about the positive Greek accomplishments. And so we basically, my father, coming from Greece to America, always wants to teach his son about Greek things. So whenever we saw the symbol of the fish on the back of a car, now I don't know, if people in Iran know, but in America, anybody who's proud to be a Christian, they usually put a fish on the back of their car. But most Christians in America don't know why. They think they know why. They say, because Jesus was a fisher of men, because right. Peter was a fisherman. No. It started out because the Christians in the early days of the faith were persecuted brutally by the Roman Empire and by others, so they had to be secret about their faith. So they used the symbol of the fish because the Greek word for fish is ichthys, and the acronym, the letters of the word ichthys, which is iota, chi, theta, epsilon, sigma, spells Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Savior. So when they saw the symbol of the fish, they are thinking Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Savior. This is the secret symbol.
Yeah.
And my father, he would see the fish on the back of a car. We're driving someplace, and I'm 12 years old, and he says, hey, do you know what that is? That's a Greek word. He's excited, more excited about the Greekness of the word than about the meaning. I'm joking. But he says, it's Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Savior. That's a Greek word, and he tells me the whole story. So I always had this idea in my mind. Also, I did a lot of fishing growing up. It was my hobby, you know, to stay out of trouble. I studied, do homework, watch TV, and would go fishing. And when I was in college, I was trying to figure out the meaning of life. This is the third piece, so the dream makes sense. So when I was a little older, I'm in college trying to figure out the meaning of life, and I'm starting to think about maybe all religions are saying the same thing. That's not true, but you're taught to think about that, right? That, oh, they're all saying the same thing. And I had this idea, which I got from reading Sigmund Freud and Carl Jung, the idea that maybe, you know, Jung talks about the collective unconscious, it's this God energy or something. It has nothing to do with what's true, but this is the idea of these crazy intellectuals. And they talk about the collective unconscious, and I thought maybe the goal of life, it's like when you're on a lake with ice, is to drill through the ice. The ice is the conscious mind, and beneath it is the unconscious, the collective unconscious. Now, I want to say again, this is nonsense, but in my mind, when you're an undergraduate studying, you kind of get these ideas. So I thought maybe the goal of all religions is the same, to drill through the ice, the conscious mind, to touch the collective unconscious, something spiritual. Okay, that's it. So in the dream, I'm standing on Candlewood Lake in Danbury, Connecticut, where I grew up, and we're ice fishing. And it's middle of winter, of course, there's ice on the lake, and it's very bright sun and snow and ice. And I look down, there's a hole in the ice about the size of this here, and there's a fish sticking its snout out of the hole. Now, if you ever ice fish, this never happens in a million years, but in the dream, I look down, and I reach, and I pick it up, and it was a pickerel or a pike, which is a big fish with a kind of a bronze coloring. And in the dream, because of the sunlight, the fish I'm holding up looks golden. And then in the dream, I realize, no, it doesn't look golden. This is like a fairy tale. It is a golden fish, alive and made of gold. And suddenly in the dream, as though God gave me this knowledge in one second, I realized God was saying to me, Eric, you just wanted to touch this water. You think this is the collective unconscious. He says, I have something better for you. I have my Son, your Savior, Jesus Christ, ichthys, the fish, the golden fish. And in the dream, I knew that God, in a way, so took my flawed symbolic idea and flipped it and says, this is what you're looking for. Not an energy force, my Son, your Savior, Jesus Christ. And in the dream, I knew this was God speaking to me. Yeah. I knew he used these symbols to speak just to me. Amen. And this is Hormoz, this is the most amazing thing.
Yeah.
God loves each of us individually. He's not just up there, some forbidding, judging God. He wants a relationship with every child of his individually, to speak individually, the way we speak tenderly to a child. You speak differently from this brother to this sister to this brother. You speak individually. How can I speak to them directly if you love them?
Yeah.
So he spoke to me so dearly and sweetly and directly that it just exploded my ability to resist. I said, this is God. There's no way. And when I woke up, I told my friend, who's sharing his faith, the dream, and he says, well, what does it mean to you? And I said, it means I've accepted Jesus. And I never would have said those words ever. I would have been ashamed. But I said it, and I never have been the same. That's over 30 years ago.
Praise the Lord. When I listened to that dream, to me, can I share what I see that?
Okay.
I see, you know, you wanted to get a hole, put a hole and go to that world. God was saying, you don't need to. Because from that world, I send my fish to you.
That's it. Theologically, it makes sense. I didn't realize this then.
Yeah.
But in the years since, I said, If God gives you a dream, it makes perfect theological sense.
Yeah, that's right.
Why did Jesus come from there to here? Yeah. He came to die for us.
That's right.
Why did this fish come from the water, out of the water, to me? To die. What happens when a fish comes out of the water?
That's
it comes to die, but he dies so that you can go with him to the place where we all belong. And so the title of my book is Fish Out of Water, and we are all fish out of water. We're looking for heaven. We're looking for home. We feel uneasy. We know something's wrong, but we don't know what it is. And God says, I have come to you to take you with me to heaven, and you can start now by believing in me, but when you die, you don't die. You come with me forever to live in the place that you were created to live. I mean, so theologically it makes sense.
Awesome.
It's kind of amazing.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Tell me about your feeling the first day. You have seen the dream.
Yeah.
And you get up and you tell your friends. What was going on in your heart, in your emotional side? Were you happy? Were you surprised?
Yes. I was filled with joy. Yeah. And I always say this too, that if you know Jesus, you have joy. You don't become religious and guilty. And just the opposite. You have freedom. You have joy. You know that God loves me, and if anything's wrong, he wants me to take my problems to him. And I knew all of this instantly because this was such a miracle. I mean, I really accepted him. And so suddenly, I was living like a different life. I was, you know, I was the same, but it was like, I say it's like if you have a car with no gas in the tank. Suddenly, I had gas in the tank, and I'm able to drive and to do what I'm supposed to do. So I prayed and I said, okay, God, now that I know you're there, help me to find my meaning in life. What job do you want for me or whatever? And so since then, he guided me in many cases miraculously to different jobs, to different things. Meeting my wife was miraculous. I mean, many small miracles, but I don't use the word miracle lightly. I mean, real miracles. And not everybody experiences miracles, but the point is that God wants to lead us and guide us. And so this was for me instant. I mean, I can tell you the most important thing. I stopped sleeping with my girlfriend. We were together for 3 years. Instantly, I said, no, that's for marriage. God made this for marriage.
And, how did you know that?
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's like, I think people know things, but they don't want to think about it. In this moment, I said,
it was clear.
God loves me so much, I want to honor him with my life. But it was a joy. It wasn't a sacrifice.
Awesome.
It was a joy. I said, I want to be fully available to God in everything because I know whatever he has for me is better than what I have for myself.
Amen.
But until that moment, I didn't believe it. But from then, I believed it.
You know, what's amazing is, you know, the religions, all kinds, the New Age, Eastern, all kinds, is a process. You go, especially Eastern religion, you have to search the truth. You go talk to the guru and find the meaning of life, find yourself.
Right.
And now you're instantly, things are clear to you.
Well, this is the difference between believing in Jesus and every other religion.
Yeah.
The religion of Jesus destroys religion. Yeah. And what I mean by that is that when you think about religion, everybody knows something's wrong. And we create these religions to say, how can I work my way from this place of misery up some ladder to touch God or to touch heaven? Christianity is the opposite. Christianity says you can never climb the ladder to touch God. The ladder is infinite. But if you ask God to come to you, he can come the infinite distance. And so when you accept Jesus by faith, instantly he comes to make this distance zero. And this doesn't mean that in this from that moment you don't change, because once you accept Jesus by faith, I mean, I've seen myself change, and in a way you are on a process.
Yes.
But it's a different process. You're not trying to earn your way to heaven. You realize God already paid for this for me. He paid on the cross, and I'm in heaven, and I'm in heaven by faith now, even when I'm still here, by the life of God inside me. I'm already with him in eternity. But then from now till the day I am with him in heaven, I am growing in my faith.
Amen.
So it's, you know, it's both. Yeah.
Well, you dedicated your life to the Lord, and now God has used you to touch millions of lives just by saying, yes, God. And he has, I'm sure, you're talking about miracles, I'm sure he opened many doors
many,
for you.
Yes, many.
To be where you are.
Yeah.
A well-known speaker, well-known host for radio, television, your books. I think those are just by saying yes to God.
Oh, there's no doubt about it.
It's not your effort to just.
People have no idea what they're missing.
Yeah.
Let me put it that way, is that people think, I want this, I want this. You have no idea what God has for you. Yeah. And that's the whole thing, is that I wasn't convinced until then. For me, it was instant. But when you understand that, if I give my life to God, God's not going to embarrass me. God is not going to shame me. God is going to give me something that is beyond anything else. And I know this. In other words, people say, oh, that's very, you have a lot of faith. No, no, no. This is true, and I happen to have the gift to know that it's true. I can't take credit for that. I mean, it was God who broke through to me.
Praise God. I want you to talk to our audience.
There are people watching? There's an audience?
Yeah, there are. They're all over in their homes. They are like that, watching you, every word you say, because there is such a supernatural hunger. And you're speaking to their heart. As I said, one-third of Iranians in a survey have said, there's no God, atheism, or it's not relevant to my life.
Yeah.
I want you to talk to those. First to the atheist.
Yeah.
That's your camera.
Yeah, I got a camera.
Yeah, you got a camera. Well, just look in their eyes and say, those who think atheism is the way to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, this is the thing. I always wondered how people can die for their faith. And I realized, if you know it's true, I don't mean you hope it's true.
Yeah.
Before I became a Christian, I hoped maybe it's true. But once you know it's true, you're stuck. You say, I know it's true. This is not my philosophy. This is not my idea. This is something you know. And when you experience God in that way, you can't go back. It changes everything. And I've experienced God in this visceral way with some miracles so many times that if somebody tries to argue with me, like, maybe, is it possible he's not real? Is it possible? I can have this argument, but there's no chance that I can pretend I'm not sure. It's possible to be sure. And one thing I can say for sure, I mean, I will bet my life on it, God is real. The possibility that he doesn't exist, that he's not real, is zero. And I've looked into it enough that I know that. I don't say that just hoping people will believe me. I mean, I say it because it's true, and I would stake everything on it. Now, this is something I maybe couldn't have said with the same confidence I have now, but I've read so many books and looked into this because I remember what it was not to believe. I remember vividly what it is to not even be sure there's a meaning of life or that anyone can find it, much less I could find it. And I have compassion for people who aren't where I am. And so a lot of what I write, most of my books I write for people who are searching or they're not sure, because I think we do need some help. And if it weren't for my friend to talk to me and to explain things in the Bible and to pray for me so that I had this miracle. But the idea that there's no God, is the chance of that is zero. Even science, I'll say my next book, which is coming out in the fall, and I hope I can come here maybe to talk about it, but science in the last 30 or 40 years has just devastated the idea there's no God. Devastated. You never hear about it. You don't hear about it in American media. You don't hear about it anywhere. And I have found so much stuff. I said, I need to get the word out because the secular media in America doesn't like to talk about this. But it is devastating information. And I will say to people what my friend said to me. He says, ask God, if he's real, to show himself to you. Just ask him from your heart, if you're real, show yourself to me, however you choose, if you're real. God speaks to each of us in different ways. He has ways. He can do things that you'll know this was a miracle, and everybody else will say, what's the big deal? But you'll know. I just encourage people, test God in that way. Say, Lord, if you're real, just make me aware of it. Make me have some experience or to understand something so that it becomes real to me. But it's kind of like saying, do you believe math is real? Do you believe 1 + 1 = 2? I mean, it's true. Can I convince somebody? That's another story. But we're talking about truth. We're not talking about philosophy and religion. We're talking about the bedrock of all reality is God, who created the world. And so I say it with real confidence because I know I was so lost that I had no idea that anyone could believe this. And now that I know, I want everyone to have this, because this is why we're on this earth. And once you accept Jesus, he can show you things that he can't show you before. I guess I will put it that way.
Amen. Amen. You know, people think it's a big journey to find the truth. They, in religion, as you said, they think they have to take these steps.
Yeah.
And the intellectuals also said, is that
well,
easy?
The intellectuals are in the worst place because right. they have confused things.
So how could that be simple? I got a PhD and I don't still understand it. And you,
that's probably why you don't understand
it. Education, you say you understand it?
Well, that's the thing is that Jesus makes it very clear that he's speaking on, you know, you have an x-axis and a y-axis. This is like a z-axis. Right. People who are very simple can get it, and people who are brilliant can miss it. And that's why we're talking about something. It's not intelligence. It's not education. It's wisdom. Wisdom from God is another thing. A simple person can have godly wisdom, and a brilliant person can be brilliant and have the opposite, have foolishness. And so that's what's so interesting, and it's infuriating to some intellectuals because they think this is idiotic. This is not, because they see everything through the lens of information and education. Not everything comes through that lens. And when you read the words of Jesus, he says over and over and over, you have to become as a child. Yeah. What does he mean? That we're supposed to, you know, behave in a childish way? No, he just means that the simplicity of a child is the door to what we're talking about. And if you cannot humble yourself to crawl through this door, you won't find it. You have to humble yourself to come through this door to be as a child. Are you willing? If you're suffering, you're willing, usually. Yeah. But if everything is going great, you say, I don't need that. So this is, it's a strange thing.
Amen. And suffering, a lot of people in Iran are suffering. And that's why I think one big reason Iran is spiritually open to everything, not just Christianity. They're looking. They're looking to Eastern religion, they're looking into cults, into even atheism or Satan worship. I mean, that's
It is true that we are made to look for something. We say, this can't be it, this can't be it. And that's the problem, is that if you don't get the truth, you're going to get some counterfeit. And I know many people that they've been taken on these paths. And you know, this is, we're talking about the God who made us. Amen. When you think about it, he made you. He didn't even just make you. He invented you. He invented you. He knows you with a detail that you'll never know yourself. No one can ever know you. So how could we not want to know that God? Amen. That is God. Everything else is counterfeit gods. And, you know, you have to ask God who is real to show himself to you so you won't be deceived. Because many people can spend decades on these sad paths.
Amen. Don't be deceived. There is a truth, and there is a true God. And if you search him, he will find you. You find him, he will find you. He is after you more than you're after him.
Amen.
And when you encounter him, just like Eric, your life will be transformed. Higher education, like Eric, or maybe little education. For God, that doesn't matter. His truth is so simple, as Eric said, even a child understands. If you have not made that decision, just invite Jesus. Just say, Jesus, I want you in my life, in my heart. Come and save me. A simple prayer. He will change your life. God bless you. Thank you, Brother Eric. I appreciate you.
It's my great honor.
And share your
God
life
bless
with
your
us.
Audience.
Wonderful.